Good one.
If the town council-elect would join me in the front of the podium, please.
Excuse me, I should have said town clerk.
Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I solemnly swear.
I solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
I support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And of the state of Maine.
And of the state of Maine.
That I will.
I will.
In all respects. Observe the provisions of the charter.
Observe the provisions of the charter.
And the ordinances of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
And the ordinances of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And will faithfully discharge.
Faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
Duties of the office.
Of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Why don't you introduce them, Deb?
It's my pleasure to introduce the school board-elect, Keith Witherell, Kevin Sweeney, and John Bridge. Gentlemen, if you please raise your right hand, repeat after me. I solemnly swear.
I solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
I will support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And of the state of Maine.
And of the state of Maine.
That I will.
That I will.
In all respects.
All respects.
Observe the provisions.
Observe the provisions.
Of the charter and ordinances.
Charter and ordinances.
Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Town of Cape Elizabeth.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
Statutes of the state of Maine.
And will faithfully discharge.
Will faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Of the Cape Elizabeth School Board.
Of the Cape Elizabeth School Board.
Thank you.
Okay, now, will the town clerk call the roll, please?
Counselor Barry.
Present.
Counselor Beyer.
Present.
Counselor Fritz.
Present.
Counselor Groff.
Here.
Counselor Jordan.
Yeah.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
And Counselor Reed.
Here.
The next order of business is that we'll stand, salute the flag. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Reports and correspondence. Anybody got any reports they'd like to give? Anybody got any? Yes, Counselor Garr.
I attended last week a meeting of our committee that is putting together a long-term recreational plan and study for the town. At their invitation, in fact, all members of the council were invited. And I just wanted to report that the committee is making progress. It's really community services that is leading this charge, attempting to analyze all our recreational facilities, from tennis courts to gyms to fields to across the spectrum. They are also looking at other communities, and the hope is that their report back to the council will be done by February of this year. And I urge them to try to keep to that date. It's a very hard-working group, and I was very impressed with the efforts that they've made so far.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Yeah, a couple of matters. First, I want to thank Deborah Lane for her efforts while I was away on vacation. I think everyone was aware that I was gone most of the time since the last council meeting, and she filled in very ably, and I appreciate all the extra time she devoted and attention she gave to various municipal issues. Second, I would like to note that this is, yes.
It's my pleasure.
Your pleasure.
Second, I would like to note that this is the last regular council meeting between now and the end of the month, when we will be having two retirements from the town workforce. Don Tubbs is going to be retiring as a sergeant from the Cape Elizabeth Police Department, and Jerry Daigle is retiring as our assessor code enforcement officer. They have a combined service of over 50 years to the community, have done a tremendous amount of service, helping out individual citizens with many issues and problems over the years, and the town owes them a great debt of gratitude for their services to the community, and I know everyone joins me in wishing them well for their retirement, so thank you.
Anybody else? Moving right along, I believe Councilor Reed has some dedication she would like to read off, pass out. Anybody's present?
Mr. Strout, would you come beside me for a moment, please? I know. It is my pleasure to honor Coach Strout and give this Town of Cape Elizabeth Town Council proclamation for the Cape Elizabeth Girls Tennis Main Class B Championship. And I would like to ask the tennis team, the girls tennis team, and the boys tennis team to please come up.
Yeah, the captains are here.
The captains.
Yep.
Thank you. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth girls tennis team recently earned their eighth consecutive Main Class B State Tennis Championship, and whereas winning the final game is a culmination of another successful season for this team with a 16-0 record following a 15-1 1996 championship season, and whereas the team was part of the Fab Four, which won four state championships for Cape Elizabeth High School in a single day, which is truly an amazing record of sports achievement, and whereas the entire Cape Elizabeth community is proud of the accomplishments of the members of the team, and now, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Girls State Champions, and we praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, for their school, and for their community, dated this ninth day of June 1997 in Cape Elizabeth, Maine, and signed by the Town Council. Thank you. Jamie. Okay, and for the boys tennis team, the Town of Cape Elizabeth, with this Town Council proclamation, honor the Cape Elizabeth Boys Tennis Main Class B Championship. And whereas the Cape Elizabeth Boys Tennis Team recently earned the Main State B Tennis Championship, and whereas winning the final game was a culmination of another successful season for this team, with results in the team winning four out of the last five state championship trophies, and whereas the team was part of the Fab Four, which won four state championships for Cape Elizabeth High School in a single day, which is truly an amazing record of sports achievement, and whereas the entire Cape Elizabeth community is proud of the accomplishments of members of the team, and now therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the boys, the Cape Elizabeth boys tennis state champions, and we praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, for their school, and their community, dated this ninth day of June 1997 in Cape Elizabeth and signed by the Town Council.
Thank you,
Zach. Okay. And I asked Mr. Strout to stay because the boys lacrosse team is having their banquet.
That's correct.
Any girl?
Yep.
That girls would like captains to are join? Ms. Minden? I can't see with these and I can't see without them, you see? the Town of Cape Elizabeth and the Town Council Proclamation. Cape Elizabeth Girls Lacrosse Main School Athletic Directors Division II Championship. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Girls Lacrosse Team recently earned their first ever Main School Athletic Directors Division II Championship, Lacrosse Championship, and whereas winning the final game was the culmination of a second successful season for this team with a 13-0 record, following a near-perfect 1996 season, and whereas the team was part of the Fab Four, which won four state championships for Cape Elizabeth High School in a single day, which is truly an amazing record of a sports achievement, and whereas the entire Cape Elizabeth community is proud of the accomplishments of the members of this team, we therefore, now therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Girls Lacrosse State Champions and praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, their school, and this community. And this is also dated the 9th of June, 1997, in Cape Elizabeth and signed by the Town Council. And also, the Town of Cape Elizabeth, through this Town Council proclamation for the Cape Elizabeth Boys Lacrosse Main Interscholastic Division I Champion, whereas the Cape Elizabeth Boys Lacrosse Team recently earned their eighth straight Maine Interscholastic Division I Lacrosse Championship, and whereas winning the final game was the culmination of another successful season, and this perfect record for the championship for every year of the 1990s, and whereas the team was part of the Fab Four, which won four state championships for Cape Elizabeth High School in a single day, which is truly an amazing record of sports achievement, and whereas the entire Cape Elizabeth community is proud of the accomplishment of the members of this team, now therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Boys Lacrosse State Champions and praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, the community, and for their school, signed and dated today by the Town Council. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next item is citizen discussion period of items not on the agenda. Anybody got anything they'd like to bring forward that isn't on the agenda? Oh, I thought they were waving to me. Okay. So we'll move on, and the next item of business is the election of a town council chairman for the ensuing year. Do I hear a nomination? Councilor McGinney.
I nominate Joseph Groff.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other nom? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's all yours, Joe.
Thank you.
I hope I didn't steal your thunder.
Welcome back, Billy.
Thank you.
Moving forward, we have the consent agenda, Part A, organization for Town Council, 1997 and 1998. Is there any member of the Town Council who wishes to take any of the items 2 through 15, which are on this consent agenda, Part A, off the consent agenda? Hearing no individual who wishes to take these matters off the consent agenda, is there a motion as to the adoption of town council rules?
So moved.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Appointment of finance committee chairman. Is there a motion?
Could I make a point of order here? If we're going to do this as a consent, can we just do them all at once and maybe save some time?
We could. Is there anybody who would like then to make one motion that would encompass 2, 3 through 15?
So moved.
And I think then we could have somebody, what I'm really asking for then is someone who would like to read the nominees.
I will do that. I would also like to add that, unless somebody has a more updated version, on the Thomas Jordan Grant Subcommittee, we need to indicate that the nominee, Henry Berry, was for the term expiring 6/99, and the term of Bill Beyer was to end in 6/00, 6/2000.
Does anyone have an objection to that amendment to the consent agenda? Fine.
Okay. The nominees are Finance Committee Chairman John McGinty. Finance Committee is a committee of the whole. Carol Fritz, Henry Berry, Bill Jordan, Rosemary Reed, Bill Beyer, and Joe Groff. Appointments Committee Chairman Rosemary Reed. Committee members Henry Beyer and Henry Berry. Ordinance Committee Chairman Bill Jordan. Committee members John McGinty and Carol Fritz. The Thomas Jordan Grants Subcommittee are, as I mentioned, Henry Berry, term expiring 6/99, John McGinty, term expiring 6/98, and Bill Beyer, term expiring 6/2000. Maine Municipal Association Policy Committee, Bill Beyer. RWS Board of Directors, Irv Chappell. RWS Alternate, Carol Fritz. PACS Policy Committee, Mike McGovern. COG Executive Committee, Carol Fritz. COG General Assembly, Rosemary Reed. COG Alternate, Bill Jordan. Portland Headlight Chairman, Joe Groff. And Portland Headlight Vice Chairman, Henry Berry.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Next item of business is the minutes of the May 5th, 1997 meeting. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
I move they be adopted as printed.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Next item is item 16. It's also on the consent agenda part B. It's a request from the Good Table for a renewal of malt spirituous and Venus liquor license. Since there is just one item, is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. Item 17 is a request to carry forward certain balances. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I'll quickly go through the proposed list, particularly for the newer councils who may not be aware of some of the issues, as well as for the public. The police donation fund, it's proposed to carry forward a little over $2,200. Occasionally, citizens send funds asking them to be used for police purposes. This is that account. Similarly, fire donation fund, $950. We have been setting aside $40,000 a year in a fire vehicle reserve, proposed to carry forward the balance in that account, which is now $44,000. We've been implementing a geographic information system office in the assessing codes planning that will serve other departments as well, $15,885. ADA improvements, $2,383. Roadway improvements, $97,966 less June expenses. Sidewalk replacements, $19,246 less June expenses. Computer upgrade is going to be proposed to change this title in next year's budget to information technology, $54,416. Guarded mansion stabilization, $9,454. Field irrigation systems, $1,291. Library computer upgrades, we actually do expect this to be spent between now and the end of the month, $13,054. Library improvements, $6,000. Transfer station repairs, $25,000. There was an additional equal sum in next year's budget to structurally help the building where the hopper is. Some of that steel is now over, it's about 20 years old, starting to show signs of wear, as well as some of the other equipment there. Town Hall painting, $10,000. We have a contract out to have that done this summer. It was also planned that we would spend some money as well for some interior work and drape. Some of you have looked at them, you see the linings are in pretty sad shape. Greenbelt work, $7,500. This is going to be a match for some work at Great Pond that has already been approved by the state. Front-end loader, this again was spread over 2 years' budget, $50,000 last year's budget, the additional balance in this year's budget. Pleasant Avenue is being reconstructed beginning next month, $45,789, less whatever is spent this month. Tideshead Road drainage, $10,000. Town Center sidewalks and drainage, this is a project that's been on the books for a while, has been funded by the state. This is the local match, $150,000. Two Lights Bikeway, again, a local match, $36,300. Less June expenses. If any of you have been out on Two Lights Road, you can see they're surveying. It is my intent that we do have a draft agreement, local state agreement with the state that has been received. It's my intent this coming month to have the Two Lights Design Review Committee meet to look at the plans up to now. And one of the conditions when that was originally approved for funding and for applications was that the final plans do have to be reviewed and approved by the town council prior to it going forward. So that will come back to the council on at least one more occasion. Ball Fields project, $139,673. This is the balance of the $150,000 that was appropriated, less the expenses, plus a little bit of money that was donated in a few years ago, as well as more recently for the ball field. Fowler Road, these are temporary repairs until a larger project be done, $10,000. Town Center Signal at the corner of Scott Dyer Road, Route 77 and Shore Road, $10,000. Pool repairs, as appropriated by the council of a few months ago, $38,500, some emergency repairs. Engineering for a rebuild of a lot of the pool systems, $50,000. Street opening, $7,389. Library copy of $4,045. Gladys Brown Fund for tree planting, $4,000. And the DARE program donations, $1,359.
Is there a motion? Rosemary?
Mr. Chairman, I propose I move that we accept the proposed carry forward balances for the end of fiscal year 1997 as published.
Second motion.
Second. Discussion?
Question. How much was actually added to the $150,000 that the town appropriated?
It's in two different accounts. One was left in the old field for Cape Kids. That was, my recollection, $2,300 or so. And there was an additional approximately $3,000 that's been given. So it's, I can give you the exact amount, but it's about $5,000.
Okay,
the group hasn't begun to solicit donations yet since the planning board approval.
Right. I was trying to figure out how much had actually been spent on engineering and the permit process.
I can get that for you.
Because I had read in a memo that it was going to be around $14,000, $16,000, not including personnel at meetings.
It came in about $800 above the budget, the original budget, as a result of some of the extra work that the planning board had asked for.
So about $17,000.
Yeah, I can get you the exact amount. I did get a letter while I was gone that had gone up about $800.
But the amount that carries forward ought to be the actual amount that's left from the $150,000 that was the town council approved.
That's right. It'll be, if you notice, that's one of those that has less June expense. It'll be reconciled as of June 30 with all the expenses that have been made and any revenue that comes in from the $150,000, less all expenditures plus any revenue.
Any other discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item 18, request to transfer funds to accounts needing additional funds. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, thank you. It's proposed to appropriate $35,000 into the town council account. This is for the pool study. that occurred, as well as another, several other appropriations made during the year. Fire Department, $6,000. This is to, for repairs that were done to the two tanks and two of the fire pumpers. They developed leaks during the year that is, you know, we explained at an earlier meeting would have been considerably more if we hadn't had some volunteer help. Emergency preparedness, $2,000. That's because of heating repairs and expenses relating to the October flood. Town hall heating expense was higher than it has been in a number of years, still much lower than it was 15 years ago. $1,500 more dollars needed. Rental units, $6,000. That's a result of a fire marshal's inspection. We needed to put in some additional alarm systems and other electrical work, and some of that's still ongoing. Public safety building, $8,000. It was necessary to unexpectedly have to install a new furnace this past year at the public safety building. It seemed to be the year of the furnace. I don't know why. Overall, though, our budget's in good shape, and expenditures in the aggregate will be below the amount that was authorized, and revenues will greatly exceed projections by actually by about $300,000. So overall, we're in good shape.
Is there a motion? Councilman Reed?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the and approve the transfer of funds to account 130, 230, 250, 610, 616, and 630 as requested.
Second. Second. Any discussion?
Another question. It wasn't clear to me where these funds were going to be transferred from. Is it from the increased revenue that you had, or is it from within the budget and coming from other accounts?
It comes from throughout all of the other appropriation accounts, so that the entire budget in and of itself is within balance. It has to come from the expenditure side, unless you specifically appropriated additional funds, which you're not doing in this case.
So it doesn't come from the additional $300,000 revenue?
No, it doesn't. It comes from unexpended amounts throughout the entire budget.
And I assume, Mr. McGovern, that is because expenditures will only be at 98% of the authorized levels from last year's budget in the aggregate. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Any other discussion, questions from the town manager? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. The next item, item 19, final approval of proposed cliff walk at Fort Williams Park. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, I'm very pleased that this was approved by the Planning Board at their May meeting, if you get confused with the dates. This came about as a result of an interest of the citizens to donate some funds to also to come up with some additional funds. The citizen plans to work with some of his friends to help get the total amount. The total cost estimated is $52,000 for the project. I understand that the first check for $25,000 should be received by the end of the week. Jeff Van Fleet, who's been working on this from when he served as prior service as chairman of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, has been working very close with the donor and met with him this morning and indicated that he was asking for the $25,000 to be sent this week. So that's certainly good news. And the donor also has been anonymous up to this point. The donor has agreed that he will no longer be anonymous. However, I don't really think this is the appropriate forum to announce it, and I haven't spoken directly to the donor, so I would think, you know, we'd want some sort of something to properly announce it at, rather than just blurting it out at a council meeting. But again, a very generous donation. When the board approved this, they did say that they would like no signage at all to do with the cliff walk. We had earlier received some recommendations from our ADA committee that there be some signage. There was a feeling that it would be appropriate, since it's all being donated, to have something that recognizes that the funds are being donated. We also, as you can see, we received a letter from the engineer on the project saying they wanted us to sign a document saying that they would have no liability at all because of the lack of signage. We also, you don't have with you, but I got Friday a letter from an inspector who was from our insurance company, who noted an overall lack of signage around the cliffs. So what I'd like to do is to work with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission to develop a revised signage our proposal that would then go back to the board, file an amendment to our approval, just asking them to consider some signs. We'd like to work very closely with the Fort Committee on that, and, you know, it wouldn't necessarily be the sign that was proposed earlier that you have a copy of. The intent would be to try to work something out that would eventually be agreeable to the board and everyone. I certainly understand the board's concerns. They don't want a lot of signs, but this is a dangerous area, and I do feel that there should be some responsible signage.
So, Mr. McGovern, I understand then that you would request that the council give final approval of the proposed cliff walk at Fort Williams Park, but with the caveat that you be authorized to file an application with the board requesting an amendment to the approval in order to permit appropriate signage?
That's correct.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Before we vote, I'd like to make a comment. I went down today to look because I'm not particularly in favor of signs. It's very clear to me that it's a magnificent, absolutely magnificent place to go. It is also dangerous and does need to have some guidance.
How long is it?
Excuse me?
How long is it?
1,500 ballpark.
It will be quite an improvement. Is there any other discussion? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I would just like to say that I think there should be some signs put there to protect the town from liabilities. If you don't have it posted, I think you could get into future trouble or suits or whatever you want to call it. And I feel very strongly that we should have the proper signage there before it's approved by the council.
Councilor Fritz.
I was at the planning board meeting's discussion, and I think I heard more than just not having a blight of signs as the issue in this. I think that a lot of the issue was, would more people be drawn to using the path from all the buses that stop there, that this sign would attract them to this feature. And so there would be a lot more use, and there would be a whole change of experience there. We have not had signage there all along. We haven't had a liability problem. It's certainly been more dangerous than what this will be planned for. I think the town has been very responsible in fixing the path, pulling it back away from the edge of the cliff, and working within the Disabilities Act, and using those guidelines and creating a path that will be available for a lot of people. But I don't feel like we need signs to draw people there. If you've ever been to the Marginal Way Algonquin Walk, it is not going to look like that because it's not paved. And it isn't the same kind of situation with lots of shops and hotels that draw people to that path. But it's going to be very, very different if every busload that comes to the museum and the lighthouse then sets off onto this path because they've seen the sign. I think a lot of people won't necessarily find it if the sign isn't there. So I would like to urge you to simply approve the path but not send it back to the planning board for any change of mind. They felt that they'd at least approve it this way now, that this was the better policy, and if there was a problem, then it could come back to them if a problem existed.
Any other discussion? Councilor McGinty.
I'd like a clear understanding of exactly what we're voting for. We're authorizing the town manager to come up with a signage plan and then submit it to the board, or is he coming up with a signage plan, bringing it back to us for our approval for him to submit it to the board? I think I heard two different things.
The current motion is to approve the proposed cliff walk with the language that there is a caveat that the town manager is authorized to file an application with the board requesting an amendment to the approval in order to permit appropriate signage. That's the exact motion on the table.
Okay, that's a motion I can't support. I'm going to support the position of the planning board regarding the signage. If I could support the town manager working with the Fort Williams Advisory Committee and whoever else wants to deal with it, bring something back to us, and then if we can come to some sort of agreement and then authorize him to take that to the planning board. But to give him carte blanche to say he's going to come up with some signage plan and take it to the board, I want to see it first before I vote for it.
Any other discussion? Councilor Jordan.
No, I'd just like to say that I'm here to protect the town, and I would like a legal opinion whether we should have signage there. We just had a rescue call here just a few weeks ago where somebody was out on the rocks and got hurt. So I think before we move forward, that we should sit here and protect the town, regardless of whether it takes sign or no signs.
Any other discussion? Anyone else who has not spoken?
I agree that the final decision should be with the council.
Are you offering an amendment to the motion?
No, I think that as it is, I would support the cliff walk. But I would like to see a final plan before we vote, as Councilor McGinney said, carte blanche.
Yeah, and I'm asking, are you offering that as an amendment to the motion, that instead of the town manager being authorized to file an application with the board, that the town manager be authorized to bring back to the town council a plan prior of appropriate signage prior to submitting to the board?
I would move.
Is that amendment accepted by the individual made? Councilor Reed?
Yes.
And the second?
Yes.
Let's vote on the amendment. All in favor of the amendment as proposed? 7-0. Is there any other discussion now with the amended motion on the table?
I'd like to further amend that to I'd like to have a legal opinion as to whether we do have to have signage for protecting the town on liability. As I understand it from the planning board discussion, the consultant said that the ADA Act does not require us to have a sign.
And that's in the form of is the person who made the motion, Councilor Reed, accept that amendment?
Well, I have a problem because it may not be a legal opinion. It may be the insurance carrier's opinion that would be more important in this situation. And I would like that to be kept distinct if possible.
I have not said anything on this item, and I would submit that our consultants have asked to be relieved of liability if there's no signage. Our insurance carrier has demonstrated that there's a problem. I think at the time that the town manager comes back to us with his plan for appropriate signage, I anticipate that the town manager, prior to coming back to us, will be, in his discretion, checking with council or the insurance company or any other appropriate group or individual that he believes necessary to bring back a plan for us. With that said, would you like a vote on your amendment?
I would like an opinion on, and it can include insurance and legal.
All right. Is there a second to the amendment?
I would like to know how much different is that when I ask that we have a legal opinion. As far, I didn't go into detail as far insurance, but how far off is what we voted?
How far, what's before the council right now is an amendment that has not yet been seconded to require a legal opinion, and I think it's now been expanded for any other necessary opinion as to if whether signage is required. And right now, there has not been a second to that motion. Hearing no second, that motion is not on the floor. We are now back to the original motion that has been amended, which will, as you now recall, require the town manager to come forward with a plan, bring it back to town council, and it is anticipated prior to coming back to town council that the town manager will take all necessary steps to provide this council with information. All in favor? Opposed? 6-1, Councilor Fritz opposes. Item 20, request to approve Fort Williams Park capital budget. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, we have two members here from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, Paul Phillips and Betty Crane. Were either of you wishing to speak on this?
Pardon?
Were either of you wishing to speak on this? No?
Unless you've got some questions.
Okay. Well, I'll briefly go over it, Mr. Chairman. Each year, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission recommends a budget based on the revenues that will be generated within Fort Williams Park, the principle being that for any capital improvements within the park or large maintenance projects will be paid for with revenues generated within the park, ongoing maintenance and operation, minor maintenance and operations are still paid for out of the town budget without funds generated in the park. They're proposing sidewalk improvements, $12,000 to extend the sidewalk from the emergency preparedness parking area to the Portland Head Light parking lot in order to make the entrance road more pedestrian friendly. Tree maintenance, $5,000, stone wall repairs, $3,500. Replacing the steel beam guardrail, coming in with wooden guardrail that was formerly along the middle school access road, $3,000. That's for some additional fencing as well as installation of the fence that was removed from the middle school. Minor maintenance and repairs, this is odds and ends of things that are done, $3,500. Some bleacher minor repairs, $2,000, and helping with some plantings up at what is known as Kitty Davis Point, $500.
Mr. McGovern, I understand this to be the Advisory Commission's recommendation of how to spend the monies that have been allocated, but this is within their budget, is that correct?
That's correct.
Is there a motion?
One question first. What, of the 34,000, is that all what they're raising themselves? Or did, when you said there were some other expenses, I didn't quite understand that, Mike.
Yeah, that, I think there's a two-part question there. Yeah, it's raised from the picnic shelter fees, from rental of the two buildings, building with a family crisis shelter is, as well as day one, and miscellaneous fees for events, parking, that type thing. That's what funds this. In addition to that, the town council appropriates around $70,000 per year, which pays for the lawn mowing for the rangers and for the employees and their benefits who work at the park.
Thank you.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the Fort Williams Park capital budget as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Jordan. Any further discussion?
I'd just like to ask a question about the metal, the steel beam guardrail. Is this rusting because it's so close to the ocean? And if it's to be replaced by a wooden guardrail, is that going to be as substantial for safety as the steel? I wonder if the manager could comment on these things, or perhaps you just don't know.
No, the wooden guardrail meets all of the same standards and codes, and that's one reason we want to make sure it's professionally put in,
right,
as the metal guardrail would. It's basically being done to make it more aesthetically pleasing and for a more park-like atmosphere. Right. The current metal guardrail there, there's nothing really wrong with it. It was painted once, and they've let it chip away because the paint doesn't stay on. With the thinking, at some point they'd want to move it to wooden, and that's what the committee is recommending at this point. But the it's just as safe. And hopefully, the plan would then be to try to reuse the metal guardrail at some location at some future time. And it won't be stored in the park in the meantime.
Councilor McGinty.
I support all the budget proposals with the exception of the sidewalk improvements. Last year, when they built the sidewalk next to the stone wall at the entrance there, I felt that was a safety issue because people were walking the street, and they needed a way to get up from the Cove Beach parking lot up to the hills. But I see extending the sidewalk all the way down to the headlight now, or connecting up with the sidewalk that's on the other side of the hill there, I guess as a continuing urbanization of the park. I'm not sure that's going to make it any more pedestrian friendly. I think that people, when they come to the park, they want to walk on the grass, they want to walk up on those hills, and that adding the sidewalk, makes it look more like a city park than the rural setting it has now. All the other improvements I agree with. I just can't support extending that sidewalk. I just think it's going to take away from, the natural condition of the park.
Any other discussion? Hearing no other discussion, all those in favor of the recommendations of the Fort William Advisory Commission? Do we have a motion?
I made the motion.
Yeah, motion and second. All in favor of the motion? Three, all opposed? Three. Abstain? I missed a vote.
You better ask for the yeas.
The yeas again, I'm sorry. Four ayes. The nays? 4-3, the motion carries.
Sorry,
Councilor Jordan, I couldn't see through Councilor Reed there.
Sorry.
I'll sit back.
Item 21, request to form Fort Williams Centennial Anniversary Committee. Is someone from the Advisory Commission going to speak to this item? If you could come to the podium and introduce yourself, and then you could be on TV.
Betty Crane, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. You all have copies, I assume, of the proposal. We felt that getting this committee together should be done through the regular appointments committee to give everyone in town equal opportunity to apply to be on this committee. And it will be 10 members, we hope, plus two of us from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. And we'd like to get it rolling as soon as possible. If there are any questions, Paul or I would be happy to answer any. Yes, Rosemary.
That was my question. How many members? And you're looking at two from the current Fort Williams Advisory, mm-hmm. plus 10?
Plus 10.
Okay, and five have been pretty much designated from what interest group to come, and the rest is from the...
Not necessarily. Do you mean from here you gather we want five from certain groups?
Is that... it's just when we go to a point, I'd like to know what the thinking of the committee was.
Well, we were thinking of former Fort Williams Commission members, people who had demonstrated an interest in Fort Williams in the past, and also Cape historians, because they would have something to do with the history of the fort, and this is a centennial celebration, and someone perhaps that could coordinate children's activities for this celebration, that type of person.
And may I have one more?
Certainly.
One of the things that I anticipate, and I see no reason why we can't advertise for this soon, is there will be far more than that.
Do you?
Yes.
Well, that would be good.
And maybe this doesn't need to be at a town council meeting, but I would like to know what you would want done with all the excess interest in terms of their names and things. But we don't have to discuss that now. But having been on appointments for years, I will tell you that this committee often is the leading application getter. And I think something this focused would cause people to also very much want to be a part of it.
Well, that will be wonderful. We'll have a good choice. May I ask one question? If you do approve of this, can it go, a notice go into the Cape Courier as soon as possible?
We got a nod from the town manager.
I'm meeting with the editor tomorrow. I can.
Mm-hmm.
If
fine.
That's the wish of the council.
And if we can set a date when applications must be made to the appointments committee, then I think the town manager can advertise in other forms also.
Mm-hmm. Well, that date would be up to the appointments committee, wouldn't it be, when they can get together and...
Well, I think the appointments committee usually accedes to the wishes of the council, when possible.
What do you think, Paul? We should have it August 1st, perhaps, the deadline? Is that...
We usually determine, actually, to the truth be known, Wendy Dirzowick usually determines the deadlines. The editor of the Cape Courier will ask her, when's the paper come out? Actually,
uh-huh.
She's even made some up a few for us, because it really depends on when the newspaper's coming out. I'm not sure the summer's scheduled. We generally, it's whenever the paper's coming out, we allow at least 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. The paper comes out a week
she and others publish
Saturday.
Would it be acceptable to the, do you believe, to the advisory commission to simply have the council ask the appointments committee to proceed as quickly as possible?
That would be wonderful. We would like to get the show on the road, so to speak.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
What is the date in 1899 or 1990?
The actual date is April of 1999, but given the weather we're apt to have in Cape Elizabeth, it probably will be better if we plan something for the summer. But that'll be up to the committee.
All right, if there's a summer.
Thank you.
Councilor McGinty?
You entertain a motion?
I am.
I move that the Centennial Advisory Anniversary Committee for Fort Williams Park be forwarded to the Appointments Committee with the instruction that they used all haste in getting this done.
Would you like to specify in the motion the size of the committee so the Appointments Committee can have some guidance?
Sure, and that the committee consists of 10 people from the general public plus 2 persons from the Fort Williams Advisory Committee.
Second.
Is there second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
Thank you.
If I might, before Mrs. Crane stand, I don't know if everyone knows that Mrs. Crane, in addition to serving on the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, is also the person who takes care of the plants each and every week at the Cape Elizabeth Community Center. We used to have a problem over there with the air was terrible and it really didn't seem that homey. For the last at least 3 years, I think, maybe even longer than that, Mrs. Crane has not only taken care of the plants, but when they need to be replaced, she goes out and buys them for us. She waters them. We had some stolen a couple weeks ago. She discovered that and was very concerned about it. And I really want to publicly thank her while she's here and recognize her in front of the council for her volunteer service.
She solved the case, I take it.
Citizens' discussion period of items not on the agenda. Is there a citizen that wishes to bring a matter to the attention of the council? Hearing none, the discussion period's ended. The council is now contemplating going into executive session to discuss issues relating to collective bargaining and land acquisition / disposition. It is not anticipated that the council will come back into public session. Is there a motion? Councilor Jordan.
If I may, Chairman, I have something I intended to throw out earlier, and I just want to put it up and let people see it. When I was talking about signs and what have you for that, I wasn't thinking of anything like this. I think there should be something around here that's a little more reserved, as you might say, that we could add it with sign the cliff on. And I thought this was, well, it's supposed to hit you right in the face when you come upon it.
I'm sure our town manager will duly note your concerns.
Thank you.
Is there a motion concerning executive?
I move for executive session.
and that is to discuss issues relating to collective bargaining and land acquisition and disposition.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. Good night.
Just if I might, after the executive session, there will be some council discussion as to planning dates for future workshops. If anyone wants to find out those, they can give us a call.
Good night.